that watching movies you hate? Why would you do that? I'm curious. Why would you watch a movie you hate? Just like that? No, seriously, let's understand. I would like to understand. Okay, forced to, that's a good reason. Yeah. Forced to ragging or whatever, like my friends, like forced to is a good reason, but otherwise, when you have a choice, you don't go watch a movie you don't like, right? You don't, do you watch cricket? Like, I hate cricket, but like, I have to watch. Does anybody do that? If you hate cricket, you don't watch. You go watch a movie, India-Pakistan match yesterday, like, I'm not big into cricket. So, when my friends were telling, like, I have to go, we are at a function yesterday afternoon. We have to go home, the match is starting at 1:30. They won match. Now, they all went. I mean, so I don't like it, I don't watch it. You like it, you watch. Like, you don't watch a sport you don't like. Right? Now, would you, like, you know, most of you, I'm assuming, are in the final year. What do you look for in the next step? I mean, you can either go for a job, or you can do Masters, MS, or MTech, or go to US, maybe, for an MS, or do an MBA. Right? How many of you know exactly what you want to do next? Not because of other considerations, because of what you like. How many of you are thinking of doing something because you love it? See, now this is what, okay, few hands are going up, maybe there are a few more hands that are hesitating, right? Which is normally, like some people have unbelievable clarity. So there was this school for the blind in Hyderabad. It's like, it's a charitable organization that runs. So we met this kid some years back, unbelievable kid. So this kid was born to farm laborers, family, parents. And somewhere in the first few years, three or four, before he joined school, due to some illness, he lost his eyesight. And there was a primary school in the village, so they sent him to the school, and he was doing well. In spite of not having eyesight, he was doing well in school. So he finished primary school, and then they had to send him out for the high school. And I mean, with a visually impaired kid, and like farm laborers, daily wage earners, parents, as well-meaning as they were, they didn't know how to send him to school. So they decided to stop, discontinue from school, because like the sheer logistics of taking a visually impaired kid to a school in the nearby town when you don't have the financial means, it's like, so they did what most parents would have done. But thankfully for this kid, there was one teacher who kind of knew that this kid is gifted, very, very bright. So he went, he prevailed upon the parents and told them, look, don't stop. Then they said that you don't know what to do. Then he found out, they were somewhere quite 6-7 hours by train away from Hyderabad. Found the school in Hyderabad, which is for the blind, and got this kid to that school in 6th class. And the kid was joining the school, and in the school, like, they're all visually impaired. It's a school for the blind. And every child has a mentor. And most of them there are like from poorer sections of the society. It's not a normal school. It is for the weaker sections of the society. So it's virtually, they stay in the hostel, they have an advisor. So this kid was doing well, continued to do well. By around, I think when he was in 7th or so, he came to know of MIT. The MIT in Boston. He said, like, I want to do engineering in MIT. And naturally the advisor said, like, it's a 12-year-old saying, like, you would say what you would say. Okay, good, good, it's not easier to work hard. So all the best, will help out. And this kid stayed at 7th class, 8th class, 9th. He stuck to it and kept doing well, continued to do well, 10th, he did very well. And so to do go to MIT engineering, he had to join the math stream. And at that time he was told that he can't do math stream in AP because AP government did not have, I forgot, it's physics or chemistry, one of the books in Braille. So the AP education of higher education would not allow blind students to take the MPC stream. Now, he was very disappointed and the school tried hard, representative government, and while that was going on, he had to join 11. So he switched to CBSE, much against his wish. And he started doing it, and then the school prevailed. By end of that year, AP government changed the rules, that even the visually impaired kids could take MPC. But this kid stayed at it, and like there are a lot of companies in Hyderabad that helped the school. So GE was one of those companies. So there were people from GE that go volunteer time, and even otherwise, there are many other ways that GE was helping. So he got right people helping him with the whole process. They were volunteers that went, helped him with the application process, helped with this the whole statement of purpose and all the others. A lot of things go into the whole process of applying. He got sufficient guidance, and you know what? At the end of 12, before his 12 got over, he got admitted to MIT. He is now, he must be in the final year. This was 4 years back. And such an amazing kid. I mean, we came to know, I came to know, because they are in the same building as me, and somewhere else I heard of him also. So we invited him to come and talk. This is a 17-year-old that was looking like a 14-year-old at the time. And just a few weeks before he was going to fly out. This was July that year. So I invited him to come and talk. In fact, GE had invited him to come and talk to their employees. And I came to know. And then I asked them, and so they got into our office also. And this kid was unbelievably grounded. Very clear, very simple. And like, you can tell he is smart. The way he was talking, unbelievable confidence. Like I said, he was looking like a 14-year-old, 13, 14-year-old, not looking like a 17-year-old or tough. He looked like a 7-plus kid or 8-plus kid. And he got it MIT. Now, that is very, very rare to have that kind of parity. I mean, at my age, I'm 26, right? You believe that? Anyway, I firmly believe I'm 26. At my age, of having worked for about 20, 22, 23 years, I still don't know what I want in life. Every year I discover something. Now, you have to experience, you have to discover and go after it. I did electrical engineering in my engineering. Master's, I did controls and instrumentation. And I thought that's what I like. I had some options. I did master's in controls. And mainly because I didn't want to start working immediately. I was somewhere, though I didn't know what I wanted to study, but I want to do master's. That was very clear. So I didn't take up a job. I did my master's. And I quit control systems. It seemed interesting, but it's extremely mathematical. And I hate math. And anyway, got into a job. So many years, like about 5-6 years back, we moved to the house that I'm currently in. Now, right, that behind that house, like when we moved in, there was nothing. It was all barren. The whole area was just rocky, nothing around. And within a year, like it's very prime location near the whole what is called Hyderabad City in Hyderabad. A lot of the whole software companies are in that area. So naturally, the development started very quickly. Within a year, like there were two high-rise building projects that started. One right behind my house. And like every morning, I used to go up as I started the earthwork. They had microblasting and the foundation. Foundation took more than a year. I used to go to my terrace, and every morning I used to spend 1 hour just watching. And like until for the next 1.5 years or so, until the building came to the second floor height, then I couldn't see anymore. Then I stopped watching. So I know now in theory how to build a high-rise building up to second floor, just watching. And I discovered at the time, this was 5-6 years back. By then I've been working for 17-18 years in software. I discovered that like I like machines the most. Construction machines basically, not just machines. Now, this I never knew in college. It's a discovery process, but what is important is that once you kind of discover something, go after it. Just don't take a job just because you have a job. Right? Or you need some of us, most of us I'm sure, have family compulsions, we have to take a job that comes foremost, no doubt about it. But there are some that don't have that immediate compulsion. You can afford not to work for a few years. Right? You can do a master's, you can go do something. When you don't have a compulsion to take up a job, there are no family financial compulsions to take a job, you should explore what you like. Right? With that, I have something. I would like to talk, but let me see if I can talk through this. So I just want to talk in the next, hope, I don't know, maybe in the next 30 minutes or so, my journey with innovation. Right? I mean, like, it's a continuous process. I spend a lot of time with kids, college kids. I'm on multiple incubators. I'm involved in multiple incubators. I helped start the Triple IT incubator. I'm a graduate faculty at Triple IT, Hyderabad. For the last 12 years. This is the 12th year I'm teaching. I take 2 courses there. I'm very involved. And so somewhere in the last, from my Triple IT Association, I started off, I engage a lot with colleges, and I do a lot on the startup side also. I'm very actively engaged in the startup ecosystem. And of course, I work for a product company. Most of my background is in products. I moved to Hyderabad in 2000, and I came back from the US to join a startup that was in Hyderabad that went on, at that time, this company started in 98, went on to create a product that was competing with IBM WebSphere and WebLogic and Oracle, which is now part of Oracle, and Sun's, now it's called GlassBridge. So those are the kind of products that this company built a product and got recognized. So very happy to work for the company. So anyway, and then like now I'm working for Progress, which happened through a relationship with this earlier company that I was mentioning. And along the way, I've seen a lot of startups. So I've been mostly around the innovation ecosystem, because that's what I like. I like being in the innovation because I like ideas. Like always say, I like ideas. I like meeting interesting people, interesting ideas, and even better, interesting people with interesting ideas. So I meet at least a few startups every week. And like, if you go to my Facebook page, it's all about startups, product startups and technology startups. So I just love it. I enjoy it, all my volunteer time, my personal time, hobby time. I don't like cricket, but I like reading startups. Okay, now I'm just going to share a little bit of my journey with innovation, and in that process, hopefully, some things will rub off and some of you may get some ideas. So I grew up in Srinagota. How many of you know Srinagota? Come on, that's all? It's a national pride for us. That we're one of the very few countries in the world that can launch a satellite. Okay, how many of you know Srinagota? How many of you know ISRO? Okay, good. So Srinagota is where all the rockets get launched from. So that's where I grew up. My dad used to work for ISRO, so all my schooling was on the island, Srinagota. And it was a small island, and I didn't know much. When I moved there, I was probably 7-8 years old, just beginning to understand the world. And for me, that was the world. An island full of very smart, very bright, intellectual engineers was the world for me. I mean, I knew very little outside that. So I grew up amongst like very bright minds and very, very well-endowed school. And we're there, one of the best libraries in the country was at the ISRO. All the ISRO centers had good libraries, and Srinagota had a very good library. So many things like I took for granted during those days. Okay, I'm anyway audible. So I grew up very, very exciting, and the whole island used to participate. The whole, the colony, it's a destination, about 1,000 families living on the island at the time. Every time there's a launch, the whole island is involved. Like, I mean, the spouses, the children, like school, teachers, everybody, just about everybody. And like when the launch is successful, it's celebration. And like I was there, the first SLV-3 rocket, which is the first kind of the workhorse today, is based on the SLV family. And the first launch that failed.